God, that is our prayer today, that you would be glorified, your holy name would be lifted high. Be glorified in our midst today as we worship you, as we fellowship together this afternoon. Thank you for who you are, God, and thank you for gathering your church together today. In your name, amen. Please have a seat. Good morning. My name is Eric.
My name is Kevin.
And we work with students here at RMBC. We just want to take a moment and welcome you here to church. If you're visiting with us, we ask that you take a moment, and in your bulletin, you'll find a connection card. Take a minute and fill that out and take it to our Welcome Center. We'd love to connect with you. You get a free gift.
Here at RMBC, we have what we call the hot sheet, which highlights the events that are coming up here at RMBC. If you turn there now, you'll see that the church picnic is happening today at the Emmanuel campus. Head over there after the service and enjoy food, some fun, and fellowship with those people who attend RMBC. And bring a friend if you want to. I want to double highlight the summer camp registration is now open. It's time to go to Heartland. We're taking kids up to Heartland.
Will you please raise your hand if you've ever attended Heartland as a camper?
Wow.
A lot of people.
Heartland must be doing something right.
They must be. But no, we're really excited. It's our privilege to work with students and to take them up for this week away from the busyness and the chaos of life. And there's no cell phones or text messaging. And grandparents and parents said amen, because that's a fantastic thing to rip out of their hands. But it's a good time for them just to be exposed to God's beauty of creation and just to get away from the distractions.
So the date we want you guys to remember is May 5th. That's the last day to sign up your grandson or daughter or your son or daughter to go to Heartland Christian Camp on the early bird rate, which is cheaper than the regular rate. So
is that what early bird means?
That's what it means. I know that.
We had a real exciting time this last Wednesday. Kevin's going to tell you a little bit about it.
Yeah, last Wednesday we were able to take our students, junior high and high school, into the new student center. The building's in construction right now, but we were able to take them over there and just spend some time dreaming and thinking about all the possibilities of ministry that we can do in there. We spent time in prayer over the building, dedicating the building, and we allowed the students Sharpies, and we told them to go write on a stud in the building a verse or something that a prayer, leave a mark in the building to remember this season at RMBC when we can put up this new building for God's glory.
Yeah, it was great just to experience just the energy and the enthusiasm for our students as they really started to grasp and put together just the possibilities of that building, not just for their own use, but for kingdom use. And so that was real exciting to be a part of. We'd like to share with you now a quick slideshow just showing some of the students as they interacted this last Wednesday. Thanks.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Bye.
was sort of enjoying that song along with that, weren't you? That's great. Those two guys up here announcing, great youth guys. It's fun to serve with them. And exciting stuff happening in that corner of our campus. So we're grateful for that. This morning, we're going to be, well, I guess we're going to go through that again. Oh, no, we're not. This morning, we're going to be talking about the second coming of Christ. And before we sing about that, let's read this scripture together. Choir, would you stand? And let's read together John 14, 1 through 3, out loud together. Let's say it. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Let's sing about that glorious day. Will you stand with me as we sing this?
Come, we pray.
Day that will be. One day we will stand around the throne and see the Lamb of God. His hands will be nail scarred And we will realize at that time, like we've never known before, that it's all of grace, it's all of mercy that we're here. And He has provided a way through the death of Jesus Christ on the cross. You know, it's interesting, we began to sing about how holy God is. In world religions, if it's a temple religion, the closer you get to the deity, the less you're invited. Fewer and fewer people can get close to the deity. In Christianity, it says, Jesus Christ has provided a way for you to come into His very presence. That curtain in the temple has been torn from top to bottom when Jesus Christ died on the cross. And now we have full access to Him because of His grace and His mercy in our lives. Isn't that something to tell? Let's tell it. Let's live it in our lives. So I want to us to pray this week for Anita Anderson and family. Cliff passed away this last week. He's home with the Lord now, and so we were rejoicing from that standpoint, but we are walking alongside of this family in this time of loss. And services are this Wednesday, 9 o'clock at Kingsburg Cemetery, and then 11 o'clock here in the sanctuary on Wednesday of this week. So let's, in the chapel, 11 o'clock on Wednesday. So let's be mindful of the Anderson family today. And then Saji and Bindu Uman, they were here just a couple weeks ago. What a testimony of God's grace in terms of calling them to ministry. Let's be praying for them as they are missionaries of the week this week as we have this opportunity. So let's come before the Lord and let's give Him thanks and praise for who He is. Let's pray. Lord, it's so good to know that we have so much to look forward to. Jesus is coming again. He came the first time and it was great. He provided a way through the death of Jesus Christ on the cross. We don't need to hide behind any curtain. We don't need to hide because You're a holy God. I think of Peter when You called him to ministry in Luke chapter 5. And Lord, You did something there very personal for Peter in the lake, on the lake. And he saw You and realized that You were Lord above all, that You were holy, and he said, Lord, get away from me. I'm an unholy man. I think of Isaiah the prophet in Isaiah chapter 6, who had a vision of the holy God in His temple. And he said, I am undone. I'm a man of unclean lips. And Father, that just seems to me such an appropriate response, being in the presence of a holy God. It's not about us. It's about Your grace and mercy. It's about You choosing to come to this earth to provide a way for us who are sinners to come before an all-righteous and holy God and to enjoy fellowship and relationship with You forever. Father, that's something to tell. That's something to share. That's something to lead us forward as men and women and youth into our community. Lord, we saw pictures this morning of this new building going up. All glory and praise to You. Glory and honor and praise is due Your name. And Father, You've raised up people in this church. You've raised up ministers and lay people and young people who feel the call of God upon their lives from a holy God. And I pray that as this building goes up, Lord, that You would just use it for Your glory and for the ministry of reaching out to many students in ministry. And Lord, bless those that are responsible for leadership. We saw Eric and Kevin here today, and we just thank You and praise You for their ministry. We pray that You would continue to touch them and use them and work through them as they lead our youth. Father, this week we want to lift up the Anderson family. We pray Your blessing upon them. Pray that they may just sense the closeness of Your presence as You walk with them through the valley of the shadow of death. And as You give them a sense of living hope in this time of loss. And Father, we thank You for Saji and Bindu Uman. Thank You that You put a vision upon their hearts and their lives for a great ministry. They're going into a city that does not know You. And Father, You have given to them a great calling. I pray that You would help them as they persevere through difficulties and trials. You would empower them with Your Holy Spirit. We will look upon that city one day and say, and see what You've done and rejoice in You. Rejoice in Your servants, the Umans, as they have served You faithfully. We thank You now as we give to You of our tithes and offerings. May You be blessed. May the kingdom go forward in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Just before our choir comes down, let me call your attention to one other ministry opportunity. This Thursday is the National Day of Prayer, and across our country there'll be people gathering in various places. And here in Reedley, we have the Mayor's Prayer Breakfast at 7 o'clock at the Community Center, and then at 6:30 in the evening at the Pioneer Park downtown. There'll be a community prayer gathering. And what I found is that when this group right here, when we gather, when we join that, it seems to really give a lot of momentum. So would you just take, either mentally or with a pen, somewhere, write down that date, Thursday morning and or evening, and be part of something good going on in our community. Be able to gather together and pray for our nation. It is the centennial year of Reedley's incorporation, and so we're celebrating Reedley's centennial by committing the next 100 years to God. And so you're invited. I invite you to do that. Now, choir's coming down. You stand and welcome them down and welcome some folks around you for a moment, and then we'll continue. All right. Thank you so much. You may be seated. Good. Here with me for just a moment is our church moderator, our lay leader, Bud Clausen. And he would like to share something, just an update, based upon some decisions that were made last Sunday evening at our congregational meeting. So, Bud, welcome. Share with us what you have there.
Great. Thank you, Pastor Dennis. Thank you for this opportunity to just bring the church family together and update you on actions that were taken last Sunday night. Many of you were there. Some of you weren't able to be there, and so we wanted to make sure that everyone is on the same page. As you know, the Student Center is going up. You saw pictures of that earlier. I thought that was fantastic to see the excitement and the involvement of our youth in that building already. Part of the issues at hand are that we have a 3-year time period on pledges. The building will be completed in the first 2 years of that 3-year. And so there's going to be some cash flow needs that we will need to borrow for cash flow purposes. Many of you understand that as a line of credit. And that's one of the things that we would need in order to bring this to completion. Secondly, the city has officially given the L Street and 14th Street to the church. And so in order to complete the south side, which would be 14th Street, the triangular parking lot, and also incorporate L Street and the west parking lot, there is a shortfall in what cash and pledges have been up to this point in time. There have been a couple of individuals or a number of people that have been working at talking with some of the church members. Of that amount, we've raised almost half of what that shortfall is going to be. And so in the last 2 weeks, we've raised about $400,000 in cash and pledges. And that has been a tremendous encouragement to leadership here at RMBC. The last area is that we really want to take advantage of this opportunity that the city has given us. And I would just say that you will hear more from the church. There's a couple of individuals, Marvin Just Jr. and also
Ray Gosen.
Ray Gosen. Mine almost went blank, Ray. that are working hard to develop potential donors, and again, we'll probably have a letter out in the next few weeks as well, because we all want to be involved in this project and completing that. The last item is, I just wanted to mention that the action taken at the spring business meeting, I'll paraphrase, is that trustees are tasked with obtaining up to $1.5 million to complete the student center, south side parking, and west parking areas. And once this is completed, it will, to me, be a tremendous enhancement here on campus. Currently, we have different levels that people have to step down. We have through traffic. This will enable our campus to be a much safer place for events that are happening here on campus. So will you join all of us and leadership in making sure that we can complete this project? It would be great, those that can, fulfill your pledges to minimize the amount of, I'll say, short-term borrowing we need to do. And those of you that can also, if we wouldn't have to borrow, that would be a tremendous blessing. And so we're doing what we can to complete the project, and we will continue to fundraise to make sure that one of the things that I heard very loud and clear is that people appreciate the ministries that our church has been committed to. And so we want to make sure that we raise the additional funds that it takes to finish the funding of this project over and above the operating budget that we have here at RMBC. So again, I appreciate this time. If you have any questions, you can contact myself, the trustees. Martin Penner is chair, and vice chair is Jerry Peters. And church council members are all aware of where we're at and what we're doing. And so we would be very glad to bring you up to date if you have any questions. Thank you again.
Thank you, Bud. As Bud said once, we wished all of you could have been there last Sunday night. And since you weren't, we wanted to make sure you knew what transpired. And we're really actually very encouraged and thankful for that. I'm told that if you head up towards northern Canada in one of the provinces, there used to be a sign on one of those roads that gets really muddy and snowy and whatever, a sign that said, choose your ruts carefully. You're going to be in them for a long time. Maybe you've been on one of those roads, as either if you went to Alaska or up in northern Manitoba. The weather gets severe. The mud and the snow and the tracks get deep sometimes. And so it's important to choose very carefully. And as I thought of that image, I wanted to use that this morning to lay over our text, because living in our world is a lot like that road. Sometimes the weather becomes rather severe. We face extreme conditions, and I'm not talking just literally, but in our lives, there is stuff that comes at us, and suddenly we find ourselves in one kind of rut or another. And some of those ruts can get pretty deep. Sometimes it's hard to climb out of those, and we need to choose carefully. Have you noticed that in the Christian life, it seems that we have a lot of great starters, but not so many great finishers? The challenge is to finish strong. And while we've been celebrating the life of a lot of our saints lately, we've had an unusually high number of funerals, celebrations of life. And those have been celebrations of people who have finished well. I am so grateful for that. But in order to do that, it means that there's a commitment to a life of faithful endurance. And that's what James is going to call us to this morning. You know, there are several things, maybe a lot of things about our particular culture today that tend to make us impatient. Aren't we a rather impatient people? We want what we want when we want it. And usually that's right now. And the reality is that we're raising a generation that knows nothing quite different from that. I mean, they have video games, they have plastic money, and so it's instant gratification. Right now. The truth is that God calls us to a long journey that requires deferred gratification. Sometimes we have to wait for things. And in the middle of that, we travel a journey. A journey that sometimes can be described as a road that's pretty rough and pretty uncomfortable. In his book, written maybe 25 years ago already, A Long Obedience in the Same Direction, Eugene Peterson wrote this. He said, "One aspect of this world that I've been able to identify as harmful to Christians is the assumption that anything worthwhile can be acquired at once. We assume that if anything can be done at all, it can be done quickly and efficiently. Our attention spans have been conditioned to 30-second commercials and 30-second abridgments." How many of us didn't choose to read the Cliff Notes, the shorter version of a novel in high school, so that we could get that work done a little bit quicker? Well, with that in mind, let's read what James says in James 5, 7 through 12. Some of this is self-evident, as he says, "Be patient then, brothers," and that includes you sisters too, all right? "Be patient then, brothers, until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop, and how patient he is for the autumn and spring rains. You too be patient and stand firm, because the Lord's coming is near. Don't grumble against each other, brothers, or you will be judged. The judge is standing at the door. Brothers, as an example of patience in the face of suffering, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. As you know, we consider blessed those who have persevered." You've heard of Job's perseverance and have seen that what the Lord finally brought about. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy. "Above all, my brothers, do not swear, not by heaven or by earth or by anything else. Let your yes be yes and your no, no, or you will be condemned." Let's pray. God, would you open our hearts to this ancient text? We believe that James was living this life, and so were the first century Christians that received this letter. And now we need to make that jump and see how it applies to our lives. Our world is not that different. And so we have suffering and we have a need for patient endurance. And especially, Lord, we are that much nearer to the coming of the Lord, to your return. So help us to understand this morning what you want to say to us from this passage about faithful living, about patient endurance, about perseverance in the face of trials and suffering. Open our hearts, Lord, and you speak through your Holy Spirit, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Notice in verse 7 that little word "then," and that always points back. It's equivalent to the word "therefore" that Paul often uses. And so it reminds us that what James is teaching here grows out of what he's already said. Last week our study had to do with those who live under the oppression of the rich and the wealthy, who sometimes oppress the poor. And Pastor Ray reminded us that most of the people who received this letter would have been in the second category. They would have been suffering. They would have been going through trials. And so James is saying, in light of that, this is how to be patient in view of what you're going through. We could move back and back through chapter 4 and we'd see that there was a challenge to live in the face of the unknown, that we don't even know what's going to happen tomorrow, that they were tending to judge one another. And I think all of this still hangs on that little phrase in verse 7. I hope you don't get tired of it, because it's so central and foundational to the Christian faith, where James said, "Submit yourselves then to God." So what we're saying today is a continuation of that. There he was pointing back to something he had already said. Here he's pointing back to that. And we need to remember that in the face of what we live with today, the call is to submit ourselves to God. That's faithful living, my friends. And so now we connect this text with this metaphor that I'm using today, that life can be like a rough road, like that northern Canadian highway where we're challenged to we better choose our ruts carefully, because sometimes we're in them for a long time. And here are some of the things to remember when the road gets rough. I want to just take several things out of this text, not necessarily in the order that you see them here, but to kind of categorize them. And the first thing I'm saying is One of the ruts that I think we need to choose and remember when the road gets rough is that we should not forget one another. We should not forget the Lord's people. We need to make sure that we're leaning hard in to one another. And James here uses the word brothers four different times. I think it's important to take note of that. I've circled or underlined those in my Bible so that every time I come through this passage, it kind of like a neon light, it reminds me that James is talking here to the body of believers. He's using family language. He'd used a little harder language earlier. A couple times he had said, "Now listen." And now he says, "Brothers and sisters, here's how you are to be patient. Here's how you are to lean into one another when the road gets rough." He uses at least two reminders, two specific things, or they're rather implied, I guess, and that is one, that we need to practice love with one another. Verse 9 says, "Don't grumble against each other." That doesn't help. And another translation puts it this way, "Don't blame your troubles on others." There's this human tendency to look around to see who can I blame when I'm in trouble. And James says that doesn't help when the road gets rough. Rather, relate to one another in a loving way. Secondly, I think he's calling us to speak truthfully to other in a consistent manner. That's verse 12. There's a whole sermon or a couple of them in what he's saying there about not swearing. And young people, you need to know that he's not talking about the kind of swearing that we call cussing today. He's talking about using an oath. In other words, to claim that I can keep this promise because I'm swearing in the name of God. And the people in that day began to misuse that kind of thing. They used it one way to say, well, if I swear by God's name, then you can count on me that I'm going to do a really good job of keeping this. Or even worse, what they were saying was that if I swear by God's name, then God is obligated to come through for me. God's obligated to help me keep this promise. And James believed that that's not the way in the family of God. He's saying simply that to speak with integrity, to always just have your yes be yes and your no, you know, just very plain and simple, elevates the kind of trust that we can have for one another. And so when times get difficult, we know that we can go to one another because we can trust one another. Speak the truth. Act in love. So he's talking about family life together. Let me illustrate this from my own experience. I have a brother that no one here knows. I don't think he's ever attended one of our worship services in all my years here. And we're just very different. We have different interests and different hobbies and different styles. He's just early, crazy, early morning person. I've been more of a night kind of person. And we just seem to always kind of go on different ruts, different tracks, you might say. But the deal is, in the 20 or so years of adult life when we lived near each other, we don't now, he lives up in northern Washington, whenever one of us was in trouble, when the road got rough, guess who showed up? Who was the first responder? The brother. When we rolled our car one time and our daughter was in emergency, he was the first one there. When he had an emergency one time, they thought he was having a heart attack. It turned out to be something different, but he was in tremendous pain in the emergency room. Who was the first one there? I was there. I mean, we don't correspond a lot, but we're family. And we lean in when the road gets rough. And I believe that's James' point right here. Care about one another, brothers and sisters. That's one of the ruts we need to choose. You need to remember the people of God when the road gets rough. And the roads are rough today, figuratively speaking. The second thing is what we were singing about earlier, and I love that theme, the coming of the Lord. Did you notice that there are three references here to the return of Jesus, the coming of the Lord? They're in verse 7 and verse 8, and then in verse 9, he uses a different language, but he says the judge is at the door. The sense here that the coming of the Lord is very near, and the first century believers, they believed that Jesus would return in their lifetime, in their generation. There's a lot of scripture and a lot of teaching that would indicate that. Now we believe the same thing, that Jesus could come at any time, and that is one of the great hopes of believers, and it's one of the things that can help you endure all kinds of difficulties. When the road gets rough, when the ruts get deep, remember the Lord's return. How do we do that? James says, do it by practicing patience, by allowing God to build and develop patience in your life. And he uses that word in two ways, and then he illustrates both of them. The first word that he uses for patience is one that means to be long-tempered. In other words, don't get angry too quickly. Don't have a short fuse. And that one applies mostly to people. Most of our anger arises toward people. And he's saying that when there are people situations, when you have people difficulties, be patient, be long-tempered in those situations. And remember the Lord's coming in that moment. The second word that he uses is one that literally means to remain under the burden or to keep carrying the load, like a backpacker carrying 40 pounds of backpack up on a mountain. And you stay with it. You stay with the burden. You don't let up. And that's the word that's translated often, perseverance. And that applies more to the conditions of life or the circumstances that come into our lives. So one has to do with people, and one has to do with the circumstances of life. He illustrates the one with people by referring to the farmer and planting of the fruit. The farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop. I guess he doesn't say fruit, crop, and how patient he is. So when we're dealing with people, there's only so much we can do. We do our part and then we wait. In view of Jesus' return, we wait for God to continue to work in those people's lives. Who's the most difficult person in your life right now? No hands, please. But just think about the people that try your patience for one reason or another. Would you give them over to God? And in view of the fact that Jesus is coming again, would you be patient with them? Would you be short-tempered with them? Then he says, in terms of circumstances, look at the prophets. So he uses the Old Testament prophets as our example of those who persevered under difficulties in the face of suffering. And he uses Job as an example. Now, Job is one example who he lost everything and got everything back. That's not the experience of all the prophets, but many of them suffered greatly. Jeremiah went through all kinds of difficulties, thrown into this pit and was sinking down in the mud. And yet, in the midst of all that, he faithfully continued to proclaim God's word. And so the call is to persevere under trials, even if we suffer unnoticed. We're not always patted on the back for our suffering. Sometimes we suffer behind the scenes, unnoticed, silently. That's perseverance. Will you trust God's hand to bless you? And here's the idea, in His time, eventually. And so, in view of Christ's coming. Here's a classic story that some of you may have heard. I guess when remember the Beatles? Now, you kids don't remember the Beatles. It'd be like if Justin Bieber came to the, you know, fairgrounds in Fairview or something. Fresno. Fairgrounds, Fairview, Fresno. You got it. Anyway, these missionaries, the couple had been in Africa for 50 years. And on their flight home to retire, were on the same flight as the Beatles back in the late 60s. So they landed in New York, and some of you remember the mob scene that erupted there. There was extra security. I mean, particularly the teenagers were just going crazy and breaking down fences just to see this rock group from England that was showing up. Well, this missionary couple was on that same flight. And you can imagine the scene getting into New York, into the airport. They were almost trampled themselves. They finally got through to the baggage claim, and through a mix-up with their mission agency, there was no one there. Not a soul there to greet them. So they gathered their luggage and got a taxi to take them to the apartment. The apartment that had been rented for them. Feeling rather blue over what had already happened, they arrived at the apartment and still no one there. In fact, the apartment, they got in, but it wasn't really ready. It wasn't furnished. It was just like, What has happened? And at that point, The old missionary gentleman had just had it, and he just threw up his hands and just began to complain to the Lord. You know, after 50 years, we come home, you know, the Beatles come and the whole city turns out. We come home and not a soul is here. And his wife just spoke a bit of wisdom into his life at that point. And by the way, husbands, when you get impatient, wives often speak for the Lord in our lives, okay? Listen to your wives. But here's what she said. Honey, it's not quite true. We're just not home yet. We're just not home yet. And that's what James is saying to us here. In view of the coming of the Lord, remember, we're not home yet. That's what's been the joy of celebrating the life of the lives of these saints that we've been having lately. They are home. We're not home yet, but they are. And when your life gets rough, when that road gets rough and the ruts get deep, remember, the Lord's coming. We're not home yet. Finally, very briefly, remember the Lord's character, the very heart of God. And James uses two opposing sides of who God is here. He says in one verse that the Lord is the judge. The judge is at the door. That's in verse 9. And then in verse 11, he says, but remember that God is full of compassion and mercy. What a wonderful putting together of two extreme ideas of who God is. Let me read what J.I. Packer wrote about God as the judge. Here it is. The purpose of God as judge is not to frighten us, but to motivate us. We obviously don't want a God who doesn't care about right and wrong. What kind of God would that be? God will one day reveal His judgment to the godless, but to us who revere and love Him, judge is simply a revelation of His character. When we know God and see His character, we are motivated to love, serve, and obey Him. So here's the picture. On the one hand, it is true that God is judge. But this is a judge who is full of compassion and mercy. Don't you want to entrust yourself and your life to Him? He doesn't just have compassion and mercy. He is full, like a cup running over, of compassion and mercy. These two sides of God's character can be one more thing to guide us, to help us find our way when the road gets rough. Remember the trilogy, the Chronicles of Narnia, C.S. Lewis? In The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, which is the favorite of many, there's a scene in which Aslan is the Christ figure. And here's what, in that whole trilogy, the animals can talk. And Mr. Beaver says this to Susan. He says, Aslan is a lion. The lion. The great lion. Ooh, said Susan. I thought he was a man. Is he quite safe? I shall feel rather nervous about meeting a lion. Safe, said Mr. Beaver. Who said anything about safe? Of course he's not safe. But he's good. He is the king, I tell you. What a beautiful way of describing what James does right here. What a great description of the character of God. As judge, He motivates us. But in compassion, He draws us to Himself irresistibly. If you're on a rough road today, friends, would you lean in to the very nature, the very character of God, and let Him love you? The question I have for you this morning as we go on our way is, are you prepared? Are you now ready? Are you living? Are you living for Christ when the road gets rough? Have you chosen your ruts well so that you can be just as good a finisher as you were when you started on this journey? In the Christian life, there are a lot of people who start well. And Jesus told us the parable of the four soils and reminded us of the way we get the Word of God gets taken from us. Finish well, my friends. Finish well. A lot of things in life can suddenly feel like a rut. Life itself. Sometimes our marriages can feel like we're in a rut. Sometimes our business can fall into a rut and it gets deeper and deeper and we're not sure if we're going to get out of it. Our nation feels like it's in some kind of a rut right now and we wonder what is going to happen next. We wonder what's going to be the outcome of this. Sometimes your faith, our health fails and we feel like we've just fallen into this deep rut and sometimes we wonder if we're going to ever be able to climb out. We can't see out. So I'm asking you today, what rut are you in? And when you are, don't forget the brothers and sisters. Lean in hard to one another. Don't forget the coming of the Lord. Remember the Lord's coming. And be patient. We're not home yet. And remember the very nature of God, the character of God. As judge, He motivates us to live for Him. But in His compassion and His mercy, He draws us to Him. And I know that God is going to see you through. Will you give your heart to Him? Will you submit your life then to God because of who He is? Let's pray together. Father in heaven, thank You. Thank You for Your Word and how it speaks to us so clearly. Today, I just feel like this is a practical message for people on the road. People who are stuck in a rut. Who have a habit or a hang-up or something that has just begun to dog their steps and suddenly life is hard. Maybe something has just surprised them this week and disappointed them. I thank You that You're there. I thank You that You know all about this. I know You know all about us. Lord, today we lean into one another. We look for Your coming. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. And we thank You for who You are. You are sovereign. You are holy. You are righteous. You are a judge. You are merciful. You are compassionate. You are full of grace. And You love us. And for these things, we thank You. We thank You, Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. Would you stand with us? Pastor Randy, would it be possible to sing that, instead of this song, to sing that song we sang earlier, when Jesus coming again? I think that would maybe fit even better. So let's stand together. Michelle, is that okay? Can you find that? Jesus is coming again.
Tim, do you have those words?
Tim, can you find that on the... Look at that. It works. Let's sing this song and let's take this out. See you at the picnic, all right? Here we go.
Marvelous message we bring, glorious carol we sing, wonderful word of the King, Jesus is coming again, coming again, coming again, maybe morning, maybe noon, maybe evening and maybe soon, coming again, coming again. Oh, what a wonderful day it will be. Jesus is coming again. Standing before Him at last, trials and troubles are
for that day? Amen. All right. Let's go live for Him. God bless you.